they don't know is when you go home and get behind closed doors, man, you hit the floor. And what they can't see is your own don't need. So the next time you can just tell them it's the God in me.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Tigress Corner Talk Radio right here on iHeartRadio. I am your host, Miss Stephanie Tigress J, along with my crazy and needs Jesus co-host, Silky Milk Mike J. This edition is brought to you by Tigress Lane Enterprises in association with Silky Milk is Laughter Entertainment, iHeartRadio, and Spreaker. Now it's time for some news you can use, so sit back, relax, and enjoy this ride. Go ahead, Silky, and turn the rest of that song up. Jamming, y'all. Can't help it. How you doing, Silky?
You know, your boy Silky is always sexy. I'm just glad that everybody else is able to enjoy it with me. Amen.
Amen. There you go, rubbing your stomach again. Usually it's your nipples, but now it's your stomach.
You better know it. Okay. You better know it.
And, of course, that song y'all heard at the top of the show there was God in Me by Mary Mary featuring Kiara Shear. That is my gospel jam, y'all.
That's the black save woman's anthem.
Well, then there it is.
Yeah.
Okay, hey guys. Of course, as you guys can see, we are absent one co-host tonight, and that will be Smooth Caramizel. Shout out to you, Smooth.
Smooth. Woo-hoo. I think he's getting his nipples pierced.
Is he getting his nipples pierced?
Making himself more smoothier.
Oh, is that what it is? He's making himself more smoothier for First Lady E. Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Okay, Smooth, that's what you're doing. You're trying to spice things up, you know, in the marital bedroom by getting your nipples pierced, and you know what? Handle your business, bro.
Tangle it. Yeah.
So in his place tonight, y'all, we have for the very first time here in our virtual studio, our children. Two of our children, that is. And that would be our 16-year-old son, Mr. Michael Nashawn Jackson, a.k.a. Professor.
What's up, y'all?
Okay. And then our youngest, she's the youngest of them all, Miss Ariana M. Michelle Jackson, as they call her, a.k.a. Lil Foxy.
What's good?
They are excited to sit in tonight as our little miniature co-hosts, if you will.
Yeah,
I guess, yeah.
So what's up with y'all? How y'all doing tonight?
I'm good.
Well, I'm always feeling good, you know.
I'm hyped.
You're not the apple. What about the apple not falling far from the tree? Are you feeling sexy like your
dad? Oh, I'm always feeling sexy.
Wait a minute, he can't feel sexy yet. He just got hair on his feels now.
He a little too young for that, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, I feel you. And how you doing tonight, little Foxy?
I'm good, pretty good. I'm hyped.
You hyped up
myself.
And that's our family dog King in the background. He's feeling a little jealous right now that he's not here in the studio with us, but he'll be all right.
That's good. He about to go get kicked in the face.
Like kick him in the face. Don't do that.
Okay.
You know, I'll just, come on. Now, you know animal rights activists wouldn't appreciate you saying that, Silky.
Of course.
Y'all, he just playing. He really don't be kicking King in the face. You know, I wouldn't even allow that.
He's tempted.
Right. That doesn't mean he ain't tempted sometimes. But let's go ahead and get into tonight's news and hot topics. First, we want to start off. Wow. This has been a year of just legends passing, you know, it's crazy. But we just recently, this past Friday, of course, you all already know by now that boxing legend, the self-proclaimed greatest of all time, Muhammad Ali, he passed this past Friday, after a 32-year battle, let me get that out, with Parkinson's disease. He was 74.
Man.
So, yeah, that was... I mean, you know, we all knew that he had been battling Parkinson's disease for many years. And I think because he lived with it for so long, it kind of was like a surprise to us to hear that he had passed. Because, I mean, you know, 32 years, that's a long time to live with that. So, and then, okay, I'm a little late to the party, but I just found out today. I don't know where I've been. I know what I've been doing. That's probably why I hadn't been caught up on the latest. But I just found out today that Jan Crouch passed.
Oh, yeah.
Passed away, I guess, towards the end of May. Jan Crouch, for those of you who don't know, she is the co-founder of Trinity Broadcasting Network, which is the largest Christian television network in the world. She was also the wife of its founder, Paul Crouch, who passed away in 2013. So, yeah, I was like, well, wait a minute, how come I hadn't heard about this?
Yeah.
And also, you know, I don't know who started this rumor on Facebook and said that it was by way of CNN, but you guys need to cut this out. Somebody put on Facebook today that Kim Kardashian was killed in a car accident over the weekend. And they even had CNN.com down there. And I was like, are you serious? So, of course, you know me, I had to go check it out. And I went to CNN.com, the real app, and there was nothing of the sort. So, unless they've taken it down by somehow, this rumor is not true. And until I see otherwise, I'm going to say it's not true. So, whoever started that, get your life. And have several seats. Okay. Okay. Not that I'm a big, huge fan of Kim Kardashian. I could care, you know, less either way as far as her stardom goes.
Right.
But you can't be joking around about somebody getting killed in a car accident. I mean, that's just ridiculous.
That's just disrespectful.
It is. It's really disrespectful. You ain't got to like the woman, but don't be disrespectful. And like I said, have several seats. As my girl would say, Tamar Braxton would say, have several seats and get your life. And shout out to Tamar Braxton. As you guys know, everybody's heard that she was fired from The Real, the daytime talk show.
Yeah.
And, you know, I could say a lot about that, but I will say this, and then I'm going to leave it at that. The Real is going to regret letting her go. I'm just saying. Now, Tamar Braxton, some of you might be fans of her. Some of you might not be. I didn't even have this on my list to talk about tonight. She grew on me. At first, I was not really a big fan of hers because I thought she was just a little team too much. But it's funny because after I started like watching like the Braxton Family Values and then, of course, started watching The Real, she grew on me a little bit. I was like, you know what? I think I kind of like this chick. She all right. You know, she keep it real. I mean, she was like, she's very down to earth. And a lot of the things that she would say when they would have their girl talk segment, I actually agreed with, you know, so her and Tamara Mowry, those are my favorite two co-hosts on the show. So, but apparently she has signed a deal with Steve Harvey and his production company to get her own talk show.
Sweet.
So all I'm going to say is y'all better watch out, because if she gets her own talk show, that's it and that's all. It's going to be something different. Y'all know it's going to be something different because she's different.
Yeah.
And it's definitely going to be something that is loud and makes a bold statement because that's her. So, anyway, you kids have anything to say about that?
I'm shocked.
Little Foxy over here just sitting here putting her lip gloss on like,
who gonna fire entertained Mara. I mean, that's... She kind of grew on me a little bit, because sometimes I'd be telling my classmates, like, y'all need to get y'all's life. Like,
yeah, she kind of... it's almost like... Not to compare her to Beyonce, but they're like trend starters in a way. Like, Beyonce had everybody singing Single Ladies and put a ring on it.
It was a good song.
Yeah. And so, but she started that phrase, put a ring on it, right? And then, and she's, and others, to the left, to the left. Mm-hmm. And then with Tamar, Tamar has her little sayings, you know, have several seats, get your life. And of course, my favorite that I say all the time, lies. So.
Mine too.
Yes. Yes. So both of them have big personalities in their own way, and I think they're both superstars in their own way. And like I told you, Silky, when we were discussing, I said, you know, Destiny's Child was great together. They made great music, and they were international superstars.
Yeah.
But who was always out in the front?
Beyonce.
So I kind of feel that same way about The Real. The Real, the co-hosts, they're all great in their own way. They all have their own personalities, and that I think can hold their own. But... let's just face it, who had the biggest personality on that panel? Tamar Braxton. Yeah. She was, you know, just, she has a very big personality. And you either like her or you don't. And like I said, for me, it was one of those things where at first I was like, oh, I don't know about her. But after a while, I was like, you know what? I think I'm a Tamartian now. I really like Tamar Braxton. So,
well, let me say something on this topic. The Real, the show... and the whole I knew how you took it when Tamar, when you found out that Tamar was fired, you know, or let go.
No, fired.
Fired, mm-hmm. Okay, as they say. And I just want to let the listeners out there know that I really didn't care, but I had to care because the Tigress was so distraught.
Oh, I was appalled.
I'm the same way. I really didn't care.
I was appalled. Okay.
I
was like, say what they did? What they got rid of? Who? Can't be true. But
I mean,
yes, it was
I
true.
Mean, Tamar is cool. I wouldn't follow Tamar into a McDonald's if she was giving out free autographs. Now, if it was Tony
no shade.
Braxton,
oh my goodness. Okay, was that shade?
No, it wasn't no shade. It just, I don't know who she is. Now,
you
Tony.
Know, you know what? You know who Tamar Braxton is.
I follow Tony now.
Oh, you'll follow Tony Braxton.
I will follow Tony into a running railroad track full of electricity with a bunch of goats
what?
Chasing behind me.
Okay.
You're really...
Tony, I got you, girl. Now, I will tell you, Tony, you do have... You come in number two.
I was going to say, I thought your favorite
My favorite one. I will walk through a valley of a shadow of death with gasoline poured all over me and jump through a hula hoop full of fire for Tawanda Braxton. Lord have mercy. Tawanda, call me. I got a wonderful bed and breakfast we can go.
What? Tawanda, don't get this man divorced, okay? Anyway, I mean, no shade to you, girl, okay? But anywho, yeah, you make him turn into the sexy deacon. That's what he turning into right now.
Yes, Lord.
Yeah, but yeah, that, I remember you saying that Tawanda was your favorite.
That's the only reason I would watch the show once a month.
What, Braxton Family Values?
Was just to make sure that Tawanda was on it.
I cannot deal with
that. That was it. My God. Is she going to be on that? She's not? All right, I don't need to watch it tonight.
I think she was on every episode of Braxton Family.
But see,
Family.
Some shows she only had 5 minutes.
Well, and you would watch those 5 minutes.
Yes, I would. And I would go and do something else afterwards.
I cannot deal with you. You are horrible.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's get on to other news before the sexy deacon reappears. Okay, you guys. Actress Stacey Dash has yet again stirred up controversy with her comments. Mm-hmm. In her soon-to-be-released memoir, There Goes My Social Life, From Clueless to Conservative, she discusses transgender reality star Caitlyn Jenner. As you guys know, mm-hmm. Caitlyn Jenner used to be Bruce Jenner. Mm-hmm. And his use of the women's restroom. Because that's been like a big to-do. I think it was like a few months ago about Caitlyn Jenner. Because he was even, or she, I don't even know what to call him. She was posting on Instagram. About how he, for the first time, got a chance to use the ladies' restroom as Caitlyn Jenner. Well, during an interview with Entertainment Tonight, Stacey Dash said that she believes that being transgender is a lifestyle choice. She said that transgender people should use the restroom in the bushes because she's not going to put her child's life at risk because they want to change bathroom laws in some places. She feels that some of us shouldn't be forced to change or compromise our beliefs just because a group of people want to force their beliefs on us. What do you think about that, Silky?
You know what?
I hate to say it, but a lot of people would agree with her. I'm not saying I'm one of them, but I'm saying the fact that she was saying that she shouldn't be forced to change her beliefs just because a group of people want to force their beliefs on everybody else by having the laws changed,
yeah,
the restroom
right.
laws. I hate to say it, but I kind of agree with her on that. I feel like you guys, now, okay, look, the LGBT community, let me tell y'all something, okay? I understand y'all fighting for equal rights, you know, for certain things and like marriage and benefits of your spouse and things like that. Okay, whatever. But you cannot try to change the laws on everything just because you decide or you feel that you're a certain way, okay? And this is not throwing shade or prejudice or bigotry at the LGBT community. I'm just saying that when it comes to bathroom laws, I'm sorry. But, and I'm not a huge fan of Stacey Dash at all because I think she's, well, anyway. But I also know where she's coming from. My daughter should not have to go into a women's restroom and see what looks to be a young man who is dressed as a girl or whatever using the women's restroom. And now she's confused and now she's scared like, I don't feel comfortable using the restroom in here because there is a boy in there who looks like a girl, but I think he's a boy because his facial features looks like a boy, but he's dressed like a girl. Now and she's confused. Now I'm confused. Everybody's confused.
And his bills and all is hanging out from his
pants. And he still has his...
Sorry, that wasn't supposed to...
And he still has his male parts. So I hate to say it, and maybe some people might get mad at me, but I happen to agree with her on that.
That you know what? That would be kind of tough for me, too, because... If I go into the men's restroom, and if there's a transgender that's actually forced to use the men's bathroom, then...
No, they're not forced. They want to use the men's bathroom. Women who live their lives as men, they want to be able to use the men's restroom.
Men who live their lives as women
want to be able to use the women's restroom.
But that's gonna be a little bit too much because if I'm at the urinal... And I'm relieving myself, and I'm singing a wonderful song at the Copacabana. You see what I'm saying?
Oh, my gosh.
And somebody walk up on me to the next urinal.
Oh, Lord.
With a set of titties.
What?
Still with the male parts at the urinal standing. What do you do?
I can't deal with
Will
you.
It turn me on?
Oh, my God.
Will he get jumped in the bathroom?
What?
Yeah. You see what I'm saying?
So you're saying that if a she-he, I call him she-he.
Yes.
So if a woman who lives her life as a man or wants to be identified as a man and she still has her feminine parts.
Or as a woman.
No, listen. And she still has her feminine parts, some of her feminine parts, and she walks into the men's restroom because she feels that she should be identified as a man.
She might accidentally get the business.
What?
It'll be some dude in there that'll give her the business.
Okay.
But I'm talking about level of comfortability. I just feel like at this point, and yes, it would probably take more money on behalf of the businesses who would have to spend more money to get these restrooms made.
Why don't they create
like a family unisex bathroom?
A lot of places because, have them.
Yeah, because, but to say that the transgender women, in other words, the men who live their lives as women, should be able to use the women's restroom and then vice versa. I mean, I see what Stacey Dash is saying. I see where she's coming from on that. Because, yeah. and it's not even about bigotry or shade or prejudice or anything like that. It's just, come on, really?
Yeah,
enough is enough already. I mean,
How do you determine? I mean, because now understand where I work, we do have some that come down.
Mm-hmm.
They are obviously men
mm-hmm.
who actually identify as women,
mm-hmm.
and that was a discussion that we had to have.
Your staff, the staff
yeah,
you work with,
yeah.
your co-workers?
I mean, because they actually do have the top part.
Mm-hmm.
They
right.
have
they,
the breasts.
They still have the breasts.
Yeah,
yeah,
they actually have breasts, but they still have the male genitalia.
Okay, so you're talking about the ones that are men, that
yeah.
are biological
men
but they live as women.
They're transitioning. Yeah.
Okay, so
yeah.
you're saying that they've had their chest done, but they
yeah.
haven't had, they
the
still
rest
have their
of
male
done,
parts. Okay, they still have their male
they
parts.
They want to go and use
the
women's
yeah.
restroom.
Yeah.
That was a hard discussion to have. And you know what we had to do?
Mm-hmm.
We have a family restroom.
Okay, well, let me ask you this, though, Silky. I don't mean to cut you off. Because now, in a women's restroom, I can see where it would be possibly a little more feasible because we have stalls. So you don't know really who's in the stall next. You don't know if they're standing up or sitting down when they use the restroom.
Right.
But in men's restroom, do they have stalls or do they just have the urinals?
No, they have stalls and urinals.
Okay, so, because it's obvious a woman who's living as a man, she still does not have the male part.
Right.
So
she
can't stand
up at the urinal.
Up.
Right. So that was when we were told that we would have to discreetly, because it's you don't want to discriminate, but you don't want to run anybody away. And it's like, you would ask them, can you just use the family restroom
mm-hmm.
instead of the gender-specific bathroom?
Yeah.
I mean, it might offend some,
mm-hmm.
you know, but I mean, there is, when you have kids
mm-hmm.
and... That.
And see, that, and that's the thing. They're trying to get this law, in some of these states, they're trying to get this law passed in the schools.
Yeah.
Where, you know, boys who identify as girls should be allowed to use the girls' restroom, and girls who identify as boys should be allowed to use the boys' restroom. And I'm like, now, wait a minute. As adults, we can possibly handle it a little bit more maturely, most of us, and better. Because we, you know what I'm saying, we're adults and we understand more, even though we might not agree with it. But kids, come
yeah.
on. First of all, kids are mean. They are cruel,
and
they don't quite understand, especially if they haven't been taught, they don't quite understand, well, why is this person using our restroom? Yeah, they might be wearing a skirt, but they're still a boy.
Right.
So why are they coming into our bathroom? They still have their male. So, I mean,
My thing is, whatever you still have in between your legs, the bathroom should be genitalia specific.
Right. Genitalia specific.
Genitalia specific. I ain't got a problem with a woman wanting to be the dude, but you can't stand and take and pee.
Yeah.
I mean, you still got to squat.
Yeah.
So my thing is we understand we don't care how you live your life.
Right. It's not, because it's not our place to judge.
It's not our place.
We don't have to agree with it, but we're also, I mean, and I know I speak for Silky, I'm pretty sure, when I say that, even though we don't agree with certain lifestyles, we're not here to judge, because at the end of the day, God
right.
is the only judge, and we all have to answer to God. So we're not going to show prejudice and hate and bigotry towards you because of your lifestyle choice or whatever.
Right.
However, I still think that there needs to be certain boundaries when it comes to this type of thing, because like she said, why should I be forced to change my beliefs because you want to force your beliefs on me?
Right.
But they don't want us to force our beliefs on them.
Right.
So there has to be a middle ground somewhere. It has to be.
It's not
fair for, well, we want the law. First you wanted the marriage laws changed. Okay.
Right.
So you got
that.
Okay, you wanted to be able to get the benefits of your same-sex spouse and everything like that if something happened to your spouse. Okay, great.
We get
whatever.
That. Take care
but
of
now
life.
You want the bathroom laws checked? Come on. It's like, let's meet in the middle somewhere here. So my thing is, instead of wasting taxpayer money trying to pass a darn law, then use taxpayer money just to build an extra bathroom.
Right.
For like you said, for just
unisex
whatever.
Unisex family bathroom.
So that way we can squash all of this. And quit wasting time on it. And then that way everybody can be happy.
Right.
That's just my opinion.
Now, because that's going to be a hard law to pass.
Right. But there are some states that are actively working and really seeking to change the bathroom laws now. It's just like, come on. Anyway, Now, in other news headlines, I don't know if some of you caught the recent interview with Bishop Eddie Long and Steve Harvey. He was on the Steve Harvey Show. And this is, what, 5-6 years after the whole scandal where some of the young men in his church, who were once young men, but they're adults now, of course, accused him of sexual...
inappropriate.
Inappropriate behavior, pictures, forcing them to do certain things.
Paraphernalia, whatever. Memorabilia, and misuse of ties.
Misuse of ties. Yeah. I cannot deal. We are not talking about that. We're talking about...
I'm not talking about offering. I'm talking about the necktie.
What?
Putting the necktie on the wrong part.
You know what?
Yeah, why?
Why? Anyway, wow. So I happened to catch the interview recently myself on YouTube. And he said, of course, there are certain parts of the case he just cannot discuss because he's bound by whatever the rulings were. Because he settled out of court. And Steve even asked him, you know, even though you settled, it's still not an admission of guilt or anything like that. You know, but why did you choose to settle instead of fighting, you know, and saying, hey, I didn't do this? And of course, Bishop Eddie Long said it's just because he just did not want it to continue to go on and on and on, which I understood what he was saying. However, and Silky, you and I briefly discussed this the other day. Michael Jackson, when he was being accused, even though he did settle with a couple, he still maintained his innocence.
Yep.
He said, I have never, ever, nor will I, inappropriately, you know, touch little boys or little kids or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's like when Steve Harvey asked Bishop Eddie Long, you know, did you have inappropriate sexual contact with these young men? The first thing Bishop Eddie Long said was, well, again, I cannot discuss, you know, because of certain whatever ramifications and rulings and da 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 of the case. I cannot answer that question. I can't discuss. And
it's like, Bill Clinton.
Well, my thing is, Michael Jackson wasn't allowed to discuss certain points of this the cases that he settled. But he still maintained his innocence, I'll tell you that much.
He sure did. Like, did you? He was like, oh, hell no. Nah, that I can say.
Right. So it's like, for me, why would you be forbidden to say, no, I did not? Why would you be forbidden by court to say that?
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Because I'm sorry, if I am wrongfully accused of something that I know I didn't do, I don't give a flying flip what the court says.
Yeah.
I'm going to say, no, I didn't.
I'd be like, oh, my attorney be like, no comment. Oh.
No, I got a comment. I didn't.
I didn't do it. Throw that on me.
So it kind of threw me off when he, you know, said, you know, when he was asked that question by Steve Harvey. But, you know, one thing I like about Steve is that he kept it all the way live and real with Bishop Eddie Long. He said, look, I'm going to tell you something. I really didn't want to do this interview.
Right.
He said, you know, I had a hard time at this because, you know, he said that Bishop Eddie Long's church was the first church he went to, you know, when he decided to start, you know, really turning his life over to God. And he said that, you know, you were like my spiritual guide. You know, I sought spiritual, you know, guidance from you.
Right.
So he said it took, he had a real hard time doing this interview and wanting to do this interview because he didn't know how to feel. And so that's why he kind of distanced himself from the whole thing. And
did you notice how that baby curl he didn't got rid of that baby curl now?
Yeah, he cut all his hair off.
He
cut all his hair off.
Look like a black Shaolin monk. Yeah.
Yeah, he sure does. But you know, his hairline was already receding anyway.
Yeah.
So, you know, he had no choice but to cut his hair off.
It was a toupee. We all knew it.
Yeah. But,
it was a toupee.
But, I mean, what do you think about that, though, Silky, about him not really, you know, I mean, I understand he's bound by certain laws. But like I said, if you know you innocent, especially of when you're accused of a crime that is like so heinous, and so especially for a pastor, a man of the cloth, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, what do you think about that?
I mean, you know what I think about it. I mean, the thing is he's not really He's admitting, but not admitting. He's not actually coming out and just saying it. He knows he was wrong on some things, and that goes without saying. You know, he know he was wrong.
But he said he's not the man that they portrayed in the media.
Yeah, but the details of certain things, yeah, it probably won't get out. But I'm pretty sure that's his way of saying, yeah, I did some wrong, you know, and I am wrong in this situation. But the way they're making it to seem may not be the right way. Because you know how media has a way of just...
And that's true. And he did say that his one mistake was that he
sent pictures. No. You don't never send pictures. No. Snapchat, Eddie.
that's not what he said. You're so crazy. He said that his one mistake was that he trusted the wrong people. He trusted too many people. He let too many people... He was too trusting of people, letting people around him that he thought had his best interest at heart, you know, because he said he never wanted to be, and I'm paraphrasing, but he basically said he never wanted to be those kind of pastors that are untouchable or that people couldn't get to. So he allowed people
to touch him,
to come into. I cannot.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Stand you. That is not what I was going to say.
Like, check me out in this spandex outfit. Don't I look wonderful? Don't I look saved?
Saved and sexy.
But I'm about to say, I hope you wasn't trying to show. This is what you can look like. That's like him saying, this is what you can look like as a bishop in your 50s. Look at in these spandex muscles. In spandex. Don't I look good? Let me send this to you, young man.
Yeah. And that's what the problem was. But you know what? Either way it goes, it would have been seen as inappropriate. Because had he sent it to a woman or a young girl,
right,
he would have been wrong.
Right.
And the fact that he sent it to these young men,
right,
it was seen as wrong, like, too.
Right.
Because it's like, why are you doing that? Right. What's the purpose? Like, what is the point?
Excuse me, Bishop. Is that spandex with spaghetti straps?
Oh, my God.
With spaghetti straps.
Spaghetti straps?
No, I believe in the picture he had on a muscle shirt with sleeves, because I saw the picture.
Oh.
It was spandex. Well, it was, this, you know, those tight shirts that you guys wear.
Yeah.
And then he had on what we used to call biker shorts. I don't know what they call them now. But the tight, you know, stretchy.
Yeah, biker shorts.
Okay,
yeah.
I didn't know if they had a new name for them now.
They just spandex shorts now.
Yeah, so he had that on. So he's never denied sending those pictures to those guys, but he's never, he's never denied it, but he's never admitted it. And so apparently now he's bound by the law and the whatever the ruling was over his settlement. He's bound by that to not, you know, say yes or no, which, like I said, I still find awfully strange, because if you know that you are 100% innocent, can't nobody stop you from saying, no, it is not true. I did not, blah, blah, blah. Now, I can understand him not saying certain things about the people who accused him.
Uh-huh.
But as far as proclaiming his innocence,
right,
he should be shouting that from the mountaintops. But anyway,
I know who joined this church.
Well, you know, I was getting ready to say, you know, his membership went from 25,000 down to 10,000. So.
Really?
Yeah. And his wife, even though she filed for divorce, she later withdrew the divorce petition, and they're still together. They've been working through their marriage the last several years. So I do wish them the best. And if he did do something like this, which I'm not saying that he did, but if he did, I do hope that he has repented and that he has learned his lesson and that he's a new man because of it. You know, because I'm not going to stand in judgment of anybody, because we all have done things that we wish we could go back and correct and not do. We all have done things that we regret. So, hey, Bishop Eddie Long, prayers to you, and I wish you the best. Moving right along.
I'm going to tell you, I know who joined this church as soon as them pictures drop.
Who?
Travis.
Who's Travis?
I don't sleep with men's anymore.
Oh, you know what? I could not stand.
He was like, I'm going to Eddie Long's church.
Yeah, I remember that young man. The one who said that he was saved.
Delivered.
Yeah, he was delivered.
I don't
from
sleep with
homosexuality.
Men's
he said he don't sleep with
men. I
men's.
Like women's.
Yeah. And the last story before we get to our brand new segment. You guys heard about Harambe, the 70-year-old 400-pound gorilla that was... part of the gorilla exhibit at the Cincinnati Zoo. He was shot this past week because of a four-year-old boy who snuck and jumped down into the gorilla's habitat when his mother wasn't looking, after his mother had told him several times he was not allowed to go down there. So it's been a lot of controversy. It's been a lot of backlash. The mother and the family, they have not even gone back to their home yet because they've been receiving death threats. They've been receiving all kinds of stuff. There's been a petition online where it's been over, I think, over 100,000 signatures to have her investigated, to have Children's Services come in and take her kids. And it's just been a whole big to-do. I have mixed emotions about it because I saw the tape. And I don't think the gorilla was trying to hurt him.
Right.
But because people were screaming around him and he could sense that there was something wrong, he dragged the little boy through the water. But I think it's because he was trying to drag him to, like, safety, trying to, like, protect him. Because, you know, that's how they do, those wild animals. But they had to go ahead and shoot him. Cincinnati Zoo had to go ahead and make the hard decision to shoot him just to make sure the boy didn't get hurt. But I'm sorry, I am one of those people that say, okay, where was his mama? You know, and if you saw that your four-year-old boy kept insisting on going down in that gorilla habitat, you should have immediately gotten him away from that area. That's just my opinion.
You should have said something. Warned him. Say, you don't want to go down there, you will be killed.
Well, she tried. She kept telling him, no, you can't go, no, you can't go. But as soon as she turned her back, he was like, oh, she's not looking, let me go. So all I'm saying is, especially as a four-year-old, she should have immediately just gotten him when she saw that he was being so persistent, that he kept saying it over and over again, I want to go, I want to go, I want to go. She should have immediately, as a mother, in my opinion, if that were me, I would have immediately just taken my child away from that area. Because,
well, I tell you what,
accidents do happen, but still.
I tell you what, the little boy will be going to a zoo for a while. He'd be like, I want to go see the monkey. I bet you that changed his life. He got up and close and personal with one.
Mm-hmm.
You give him a stuffed monkey.
He gonna cry and scream.
He gonna kick that bear out the house. Get him out of here. We don't do that.
Right, right.
He got what he asked for. You want to go see the monkey? Go ahead.
Well, I don't blame the little boy. Like I said, it just seems like the mother should have been paying more close attention to him, and seemed like she should have just immediately gotten him away from that area when she saw that he was being so persistent.
Well, she shouldn't have had to change her lifestyle. She wanted to see the monkey, too.
No, she turned her back. She had turned her back and was talking to the other kids or doing something. She wasn't watching him.
Oh.
So that's how he got down in there. But anyway, well, okay.
Rest in peace to Harambe.
Yes. Okay, you guys. We want to, I want to go ahead before we wrap up here. We only have about 5 more minutes. We want to introduce a new segment to Tigress Corner Talk Radio called Church Corner. And we talked about it a couple of weeks ago. And let me just say, it's going to be very interesting. And if I may introduce it so that you guys can kind of get an understanding of what Church Corner is and the church that's in this little corner of the world. Okay? Now, we're going to take you, our listeners, into a corner of the world that not many people know about. It's called Church Corner. Every other week, we will visit the only church located in this small corner of the world. This church is definitely unique, different, and Lord have mercy, they all need Jesus. The name of this church, y'all, is Mount Calvary Church on the Hill Missionary Baptist Church of God in Christ Apostolic International Cold Beer Cheeseburgers Ministries, where the pastor, who is Reverend Dr. Bishop Leroy C. Gacho Biscuits Jr., presides over this congregation of 100 members. So, y'all, let's go take just a quick look into the world of Mount Calvary Church on the Hill Missionary ... because I don't feel like saying the rest of the name.
This is the wonderful Reverend Dr. Bishop Leroy C. I got your biscuits. Senior or junior. That's right. I'm the junior. I should be the senior because the junior is sitting right here next to me. But my daddy started this church. So,
Pastor.
Yes.
That is not Junior sitting next to you. That's the third.
Well,
you should know your own son, Pastor.
I lost count. Once again, I got your biscuits. Can say whatever he want because I am the Reverend Dr. Bishop Leroy. Here at, what was the name of my church?
You don't know the name of your own church, Pastor?
No, because the church has been here before I got here. My daddy started it.
Well, Pastor, no, actually, you came up with the name of the church.
I did?
Yes, you did.
Was I drinking?
Yes.
Did I have a cheeseburger?
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Amen, Pastor.
But I'm glad to come before you today. So now we want to go on ahead and change the order of service. And we're going to, I think the choir is going to give us maybe a selection under the direction of the Minister of Music, Brother Starburst.
You know it, Pastor, that's me.
I need you to just tone it down a little bit, all right, Minister or Master of Music, Starburst?
Well, I'm just saying, Pastor, you know, every time I get up there, you know, it's my time to shine.
I understand. You shine every time I see you. Can you cut down on the bright suits?
I'm sorry, Little Richard gave me these suits.
Excuse me, you two. Could we please get on with the church business and have the choir give us an A selection? This is your first lady talking. Lady Dr. Silva Curvilicious got your biscuits.
Amen, first lady. I was trying to give Pastor A selection. I sure never tried to give a selection, but he played.
Excuse me, Starburst. Let's get on with the program now. These people got to go home and eat their little chitlins for dinner.
All right, all right. Choir, let's come together. Here we go.
Amazing grace. How sweet the sound.
Excuse me.
That is...
Somebody is off key, and it is not me.
That is something that we need to work on, choir. And we all know, Brother Bobby, okay? We love you, but we think that you need to go and maybe just practice your vocals at home and come back to practice.
But Pastor, y'all put me in this choir for a reason. Y'all said I had good... vocal skills. Y'all said I can sing.
It's all right, little Bobby. You doing just fine. Now, y'all leave little Bobby alone. Y'all know he a little special.
That's right. Minister Starburst, we want you to work with Brother Bobby. We'd like for you to work with him one-on-one and just get him to the point that you want him to be.
I ain't got no time to be working no one-on-one with him. Pastor, you on here. Pay me to do this.
Minister Starburst, we... here at the church of .. cold beer, and I sure do need a cheeseburger. Right now, you getting ready to make me say something I regret. So from here on out, you will do what I tell you, and you will take little Bobby, and you will show him how to sing.
Okay, Pastor, but I sure enough would like to take little Bobby. I don't know if it's going to be for singing lessons.
Well, folks, you've gotten your first peek into this wonderful, yet very strange church, Mount Calvary Church on the Hill Missionary Baptist Church of God in Christ Apostolic International Cold Beer Cheeseburgers Ministry. Stay tuned next time. Will Pastor Starburst or Minister Starburst, whatever he calls himself, will he actually give little Bobby singing lessons so he can sound a little better in the choir, or will he do the forbidden? Until next time, folks, this is your girl, Stephanie Tigress J. Go forward in love, peace, and laughter.